Hello dear students, you are welcome in Literature Simply, simple way to learn literature and language. Dear students, this is time to share one more video on history of English literature. So we are making a series of history of English literature and you are watching many videos in this series. So this is the next video. Dear students, we have created a Telegram channel called Literature Simply, the same name. You can join there on Telegram so that you can get the updates of notes regarding literature and other material. Different types of material I post on Telegram channel called Literature Simply. So please join that channel. And now let's move to the video. This is #23rd video in History of English Literature. So dear students, here we have #23 History of English Literature, and we are going to cover in this video 18th century literature, or this age also is known as Augustan or Classic Age. Now why this age is known as Augustan Age or Classic Age, we are going to discuss on the same matter, because there are scholars who object to the term classic or the classical age. So why they object, let's understand. But first we will talk about the history of this 18th century literature, then we will talk about the features of literature flourished in this period, and then we will have look at why classical age or Augustus or Augustan age. Here you can see history of the period. As we in the previous videos covered the revolution of 1688, which is called as the Bloodless Revolution, and through this revolution we found that the Stuart kings were banished, and on the throne we have William of Orange, and from there we found that reforms began. So 18th century is particularly important for the reforms which already started in social life of England and political life of England. We also discussed about the two parties, Whigs and Tories, and how they were forming their opinions, how they were forming their thought movements in the England. And we have the social reformation in 18th century at a peak, and hence we also come to know that we have newspapers born in the same period. We have the first daily newspaper called the Daily Courant, which began in 1702. Now there is special importance of press and this daily newspaper, the Daily Courant, because this newspaper gave material to the people. They discussed about different types of issues published in the daily newspaper, and from there we find that people exchanged their thoughts, people exchanged their opinions through different mediums. And again, next development, we have coffee houses sprang, a new place for sociability. So you will astonish with this information that there were more than 2000 coffee houses in London alone. Now you can imagine how many coffee houses might have been flourished in the rest of the England. And there were many private clubs, and in those private clubs and coffee houses we have exchange of ideas, we have exchange of thoughts, we have agreements and disagreements over an issue in that time, and people contributed in their sociability, and we found that they build a social point of view through these coffee houses and clubs and daily newspapers and magazines, and many books were written. That's why this age is called as the Augustan age. We also find some peace and unity among people. So writers were writing on religion and party politics as well. So this also is an important thing. They are because earlier they were writing on religion only, but now they have included politics in the 18th century literature. And we also have the spread of education and growth of national spirit. Through this spread of education, for the first time in 18th century, we have expansion of education in England, and through this expansion, we got the growth in national spirit. So there also we met the power of press, and it increased with the newspapers and magazines like Chronicle, Post and Times. Now these magazines and newspapers played a crucial role in the development of ideas of England and the sociability of people over there. Now, dear students, let's talk about literature of the period. Now, this age is marked as the age of prose. Earlier, we found that poetry considered most important genre of literature. But in this 18th century, we have a very important genre, prose, and prose writing flourished at a height. Why? Because it is said that poetry was not adequate or enough to express the very feelings, the very ideas of people, and hence prose flourished in this period. So here we have a quotation. Let's read it and understand why prose. So I picked this quotation from William J. Long's History of English Literature. I quote, "The graceful elegance of Addison's essays, the terse vigor of Swift's satires, the artistic finish of Fielding's novels, the sonorous eloquence of Gibbon's history and of Burke's orations, these have no parallel in the poetry of the age." Now you see here the great writers, Swift, Addison, Burke, they composed in prose style and their prose became more famous than poetry. So poetry also were present there. We have poetry of Alexander Pope and other poets, but this poetry was not so fire or spontaneous, which did not create the enthusiasm in readers. But this prose have aptly gave way to the thoughts and feelings of the writers like Addison, Steele. We also have Jonathan Swift and others. So prose becomes an important medium of giving thoughts to the people in the society. Also, poetry was polished and witty, but it lacked fire, enthusiasm and the glow and moral earnestness. And there were two tendencies marked in this period: the tendency to realism in subject matter and the tendency to polish and refinement in the style or in the expression. And we have a very great form of literature rose in this period to a height called satire. Now, if you look at this literature, you find that satirical writing was more famous in the 18th century. Mid-18th century, you will have the satires of Jonathan Swift. We also have satirical writing of Alexander Pope and other writers. So, this satire reached to a height in this period in 18th century. Again, dear students, there are some consequences of this satire. Many scholars think that satire is not a polished form of literature, but satire paved the way for new literature, the new vistas in literature. And these two tendencies, the tendency to realism and tendency to polish and refinement, is basically seen in the satires. And these satires gave way to other literature, to the expression of writers, expression of authors through their different forms. Though it may be novel, it may be poetry, it may be essay also, we have this kind of refinement, polishness and the tendency to realism in subject matter. So they chose realistic subjects for their literature, for their composition. Now here we have a quotation again from William J. Long regarding satire. Now what is satire, or how you have importance of satire, or what is the exact place of satire in English literature, basically or particularly in 18th century? So let's read. I quote, "Now satire, that is a literary work which searches out the faults of men or institutions in order to hold them up to ridicule, is at best a destructive kind of criticism. A satirist, like a laborer who clears away the ruins and rubbish of an old house before the architect and builders begin on a new and beautiful structure." I unquote. Now, if you look at satire, you will find that this is the form which searches the faults of men or institutions in order to hold them up to ridicule. Now, satire basically ridicules the follies and vices of people, vices of men and women, vices of institutions, and it finds the faults among them and it gives a way to the reformation. And hence, some scholars consider it as it is a form of destructive criticism, because it criticizes itself through the literature, through the form which the writer is writing in. Now, though it is a destructive criticism, according to some scholars here, as we have William J. Long, but it also paves way for the new constructions. It also gives vistas to the writers for exploring new kind of horizons. As it is very aptly said, that it takes away the rubbish from a house and it builds a new house on that particular rubbish. So this is the work of satire, and I am very sure now it is clear to you that how satire works through this quotation. Let's move next. Now, dear students, why this age is called as classic age? There are some objections to this term called classic age to the 18th century literature. Now, this age also is known as the age of Queen Anne, but we found that there is no any great influence of Queen Anne on the literature of 18th century, and hence many scholars, many historians, many literary masters do not use this term, the age of Queen Anne. Basically, they use the Augustan age or simply 18th century literature. Now, what is this classic? Classic in terms of, now here we have three basic features of this classic age. We have number one, writers of the highest rank. In any classical age, you find that the writers included in classical age, they are of higher rank or highest rank. Second feature, we have unusual number of great writers. In such period, we found that different types of forms, different types of writers flourish. Unusual number of, there is great number of writers. For example, if you think about the Augustan age in Roman literature, it is considered as the classical age. Again, if you think about French literature and the reign of Louis the 14th, which is considered as classical literature for classical age for French literature. And again, here the different meaning of the word. Now, when we think about classical age in accordance with this English literature or 18th century literature, we must think about it is, we are using this term classical age with a different meaning. What is the different meaning? Next, it is explained. So this age is called as pseudo classic age, or we can say that false classic age. It is not the classic age which we are talking about, the age of Louis the 14th in French literature or the Roman literature. So some scholars use it, they consider better to use Augustan age, as writers themselves chosen the name. Now, here we have a quotation so that we can understand clearly about this classic age. Why some scholars do not use this term called classic age, and why they prefer calling it as Augustan age. So here I quote, "In a word, the classic movement had become pseudo-classic, that is a false or sham classicism. And the latter term is now often used to designate a considerable part of 18th century literature. To avoid this critical difficulty, we have adopted the term Augustan age, a name chosen by the writers themselves." Now, dear students, I hope it is clear what should be used to designate 18th century literature. Should we use classical age or simply 18th century literature or Augustan age? Because many writers, many critics use Augustan age as the preferable term for 18th century literature. It is up to you. You can use any of these terms, but classical age is avoided by many scholars. So, dear students, this is all about this #23rd history of English literature. And in this video, we discussed the Augustan or classical age or simply the 18th century literature, we have seen some features of the literature flourished in this period, and we also discussed the historical background in this video. In the next video, we are going to discuss about the writers, the specific writers in this 18th century literature. So thank you very much for watching the complete video. Please like this video, share this video among your friends, and please subscribe to Literature Simply if you don't subscribed yet. So dear students, let's meet in the next video. Thank you very much.